So moving on now to a really interesting thing we have is the Vern Chapin lecture, as we have it every year. And I have this one picture of Vern here, Vern Chapin, and a few people in the room know him, did work with him. And he was a former director of a scientific affairs, so a scientific director at the Roswell Park Cancer Center. And he was also a founding member of this society, which is quite important. And what I have learned from others, what Vern was about and why we have this Vern Chapin lecture, and why we would like to honor a certain distinct person from our community with this Vern Chapin lecture, are these three bullet points we worked out. And this is, on the one hand side, of course, the person who gives the lecture, and this is basically reflecting what Vern did, he has to be an excellent scientist and has to show excellent scientific achievements. But this is not enough. It also has to be somebody who is a community builder and community leader. So it really takes time to build the community, not only to think about the own excellence of the scientific achievements. In addition, and this is the third point, is about being generous in sharing of research tools and ideas. So take the time to talk to other people and share your research tools, especially in our community, the mice or the cells. Because there are still many cases where we have people publishing in high impact journals. If you want to get the mouse, you don't get it. And there are always excuses. So this is what Vern Chapin was known to be for, to fulfill all these three points. And this is also why we have the Vern Chapin lecture, to honor people who basically fit to these three bullet points. Okay, this year's awardee, or this year's lecturer, as you know, if you have seen from the program, is Maja Bucan. And I give you a brief sketch why we did choose Maja. First of all, just more on the historical side, she did her undergraduate work at the University of Belgrade in the former Yugoslavia before it was split. And she also did her PhD there. However, the work was done here at that campus on the other side of the street at EMBL in the lab of Hans Lerach. And actually, she was asked with a DADD stipend to work in Freiburg at the Max Planck. But then she decided, last minute, people who know her, that's the way she works. Last minute, she decided, this is the better spot to go. And I guess at that time, EMBL was something really new. I mean, today, many, many people work on an international scale, but this was a very new ground, and this was the starting point of her career there. From there, she moved on to ICRF in London, and then from there, eventually, to Wistar Institute in Philadelphia. And Philadelphia is the place where she basically stayed. And she made it up the ladder from assistant to associate to full professor over there, being connected to the, or being part of the Department of Genetics, but at the same time, and now I'm coming to what she was really doing, at the same time also having a secondary appointment in the Department of Psychiatry. And the main goal of her work since decades actually now is to understand the genetic basis of neuropsychiatric disorders. So this is the major focus of the work, especially on the autism spectrum, but also on bipolar disorders. And interestingly, Maja worked in the mouse field, but also in the human genetics field. So she's the person combining both of them. And I give you a few highlights here. So she did forward genetic screens early on, and was one of the rare labs in the mouse field working with balancer chromosomes, who you might be aware of from the Drosophila genetics. But she was using this kind of strategy also in the mouse. And insights from this forward genetic screens in the mouse basically brought her also to the way to work with the human genetics field, or the current studies in the human genetics field. Always, besides this lab work, this experimental lab work, she was interested in bioinformatics and bioinformatician or bioinformatic annotation of the pathways. And early on already, she started doing this. And at that time, she introduced the concept of gene lists. So it's not the single gene you have to really work on. It's more the lists. So it's a set of genes working together. So that was a quite interesting and important concept. And from this, it evolved. And this was in 2013 when they published this. They were one of the first, or there was the first group actually showing that human homologs of essential genes in the mouse are intolerant to mutations. So the mice wouldn't make it if you find it already in the as essential genes in the human situation. So this was very important. From this, she moved on to family-based studies. So now you're switching to the human side, on neurodevelopment, but also on psychiatric disorders again. So she stayed in this kind of field and had quite some achievement there. We will, of course, know more about this after your talk. Last not least, she's also involved, and this is again about bioinformatics and using methods and developing methods there, in making use of the 1,000 genome project. So what is our load of mutations? So these kind of questions, I'm pretty sure we're going to hear about that. Okay, so I don't have to talk about this. And so this is from the scientific side. Besides this, of course, she is member of, and coming to these other bullet points, and I will be brief, member of many international SABs, where her judgment on the science and on the structures is highly needed, and she's bringing in her input in these areas. And as I said, she was president of this society for 2 years, between 2006 and 2008. At that time, some of you might know this, we had these meetings in Charleston, in Kyoto, and in Prague. And she was very active in this community, so we really have to thank you for this. So you see this combination of high-class science, but also of being basically spending time and building the community, but also of sharing results and sharing resources. And Maja told me yesterday when she started one of her first meetings within this human group at UPenn, she was the one who pointed out that these great resources they are building there, we have to share them also with other researchers around the globe. So with this, I'd like to welcome Maja Bucan on stage, and we are really looking forward for the next 3 to 4 hours to your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. This is really a great, great event for me. It's a great honor to give Vern Chapman lecture. I remember soon after we collaborated when he died, and I remember first few lectures were by his friends and mentors, and then after that, with years and years, we had very distinguished lecturers who did not know Vern, and it was always very sad to me. So it's a great honor to be able to tell you a few words about my own collaboration with Vern. Vern was an amazing friend, collaborator, and mentor. Incredibly, incredibly generous mentor. And I really needed that because I was trained in Europe and I started faculty position in America. And by the time I started faculty position, all of my advisors were actually in Europe. So we started collaboration on genetic dissection of the patch W ramp white cluster of mutations on mouse chromosome 5. This was a great collaborative project where Vern's lab performed genetic crosses, and I think that it's Darla who sent me these pictures. Cecilia Lowe, who is here, and Alan Bernstein from Toronto did beautiful developmental biology experiment, and I brought physical mapping and genomics to this collaboration. And from this work, within a very short time, we were able to solve few puzzling aspects of this cluster. First of all, these were three mutations that were genetically really close to each other. On the other hand, we showed that lethality for these three independent mutations are actually three independent genes. Also, what was very interesting, that we showed that pigmentation defect, dominant pigmentation defect in patch and ramp white are actually due to disruption of long-range regulatory elements of KIT that was implicated in W. So at that time, 300 kb was definitely long-range. So there were several publications that resulted from this work. And here again, I had a lot of mentoring, how to write papers, how to publish as soon as possible, how to deal with reviewers. All three papers were accepted with minor revisions. So advice that I had from Vern is never to send a paper to a journal where it's going to be accepted with no revisions. And trust me, I got a lot of rejections after that advice. So we have an interesting situation with one of these mutants, with ramp white. When we put all our findings together from genetic mapping and from physical mapping, we realize that ramp white is associated with a huge chromosome reinversion, 50 megabases. And for me, I was sure that it's end of my career because I was studying a cluster of related genes, and one of my genes moved 50 megabases away to completely uncharted piece of the genome in the mouse and to completely different region of the human genome. So Vern was great, and he told me, it's not end of the world. I will help you, and we will find, somebody will find this mutant useful. I was very fortunate to come back home and share this story with my husband, plant developmental biologist, who said, just do the balancer screen. So I have to give him credit for that. And I'm going to get back to this balancer screen because a lot of analysis that we're doing now actually started with insights from this screen. So this is for me also homecoming, because it was exactly 30 years ago that I left Heidelberg after completing my PhD research with Hans Lehrach and this amazing group of fellow students and postdocs who were doing both mouse and human genetics. And this is very, very hard for me to share this slide. I selected this slide several days ago, but it's only last night that I learned that Denise Barlow, a wonderful friend and leader in the field of epigenetics, died 2 days ago. So I felt that after this slide, I have to cheer myself and cheer up you and tell you that I'm also, it's in a way great coincidence that I am giving this lecture at the first joint meeting between Mouse Molecular Genetics and Mouse Genome Conference, because I actually attended both meetings. In 86, I attended the first Mouse Molecular Genetics meeting here in Heidelberg. It was a very small meeting. Almost all speakers were invited, but local organizers invited few of us, local students, to present posters. And I was devastated because they were completely uninterested in my work in mouse T complex. And they wanted me to specifically present my work on clustering of Hox genes. However, I was very fortunate that a few weeks later, we had a meeting in Switzerland and I could still talk about T complex. And I brought the other poster with me. So a year after, I participated in the first Mouse Genome Conference. It took place in Paris, and it was in conjunction with International Human Genetics Meeting. So I was able to speak about my mouse findings, but also go down the road and give my talk about some early results on Huntington's disease. And I like to say that at this time, my dance between mouse and human genetics started. So basically, my interests in combination of on this interplay between developmental and behavioral or neurogenetics can be traced back to these early days in Heidelberg. Because basically I was mapping embryo lethal mutants in the mouse, mouse T complex, but at that time I was already exposed to this novel concept of syntony from work of Jonah Dahl and Ben Taylor. And I was constantly asking myself, what are these genes doing in humans? Where do they map in the human genome? What's the consequence of haploinsufficiency or some other alleles in these genes in humans? And also, how do early events during development influence our behavior? And as all of us, when we were students, when we had these questions, we would go to library, and I went to EMBL library and found out that I'm not the only one interested in this load of mutations, that there is a classic paper. It is actually the most cited presidential address for American Society of Human Genetics. And I still have a folder with this paper from EMBL and highlighted paragraph that I'm going to read to you. So Herman Muller wrote, all the detrimental genes together tend to give each individual his own characteristic, more or less familiar pattern of weaknesses, most of which, however, are not to be distinguished sharply from disabilities of environmental origin and which are intimately combined with the latter. This is a paper that I revisited many years later in the midst of the screen that John Schimenti and I performed. So I was very interested in behavior, and both of us were interested in developmental genetics, so we decided to join our forces. We performed a screen, and don't worry, I'm not going to go through this screen right now. I will tell you just the most important aspects. So it was ENU mutagenesis on completely B6 background. We mutagenized B6 mice. We crossed them to mice that have a ramp white inversion. These mice were shipped to F1 mice without ramp white were shipped to University of Pennsylvania, and my lab performed dominant screen for behavioral mutations. At the same time, John's lab performed very complex breeding scheme and isolated, identified recessive embryo-lethal mutations covered in that proximal portion of chromosome 5 covered by the inversion. At the same time, he was also sending me heterozygotes for these mice. And these heterozygotes were then also taken through behavioral assays. And results were astonishing. First of all, we isolated a large number of mutations. It means a large number of genes that cause embryo lethality and behavioral phenotypes. But many of our dominant behavioral mutants turn out to be embryonic lethal. Not only that, but almost every embryo lethal mutation in heterozygotes had dominant behavioral phenotype. So basically, there was this intriguing interaction, interplay between developmental processes and behavior. And while we were very successful in mapping embryo lethal mutations because they were fully penetrant and mappable, it was a nightmare to map behavioral loci because they are poorly penetrant, they're extremely sensitive to genetic background, what you have to do if you are doing forward genetic screen, and they had variable expressivity. So finding out what's the gene causing this anomaly was really difficult. So basically, these are already very important lessons that we learned and felt, or I felt that it would be important to bring these lessons to human genetics. Because of the interest in interplay between developmental processes and behavioral processes, we turned to autism spectrum disorder because it's a neurodevelopmental disorder with a very early onset. And also, as a member of a scientific advisory board for one of the autism foundations, I was basically working very hard to make sure that resources, genomic resources that we are developing for autism are widely available to many investigators from other fields, not only model organism geneticists, but also computer scientists, because we needed their help interpretation of this data. So I was very involved with autism genetic resource exchange. This is a large collection of at the time when I coordinated genotyping of the collection, there were 1,500 multiplex families. So it means families with at least two individuals who have autism spectrum disorder. A Greek collection actually started in Philadelphia, so it was supported by Cure Autism Now. It started in Philadelphia, so many families and many families willing to participate in further studies come from New Jersey, New York, and Philadelphia. The second important collection is Simon's Simplex collection, sponsored by Simon's Foundation. For Simon's Foundation, we have, actually I failed to say that, for Agree, we have whole genome sequence data. I will tell you that there is now a new name missing, and it's Steve Scherer, who's coordinating analysis of whole genome sequence. Whole genome sequence is now also available for more than 1,000 families in autism Simon's Simplex collection. A majority are trios, 2,500 trios, but many of these families are actually quartets. So it means that we have whole genome sequence or exome sequence for both parents, an affected and unaffected child. Also, it's very important to say that ascertainment scheme in these two collections is very different. In Agree, there was emphasis on multiplex families. On the other hand, in a Simplex collection, scientists went specifically to families that have only one child with autism and no other first-degree relatives with autism. So it means that this genetic load is different. So I can also tell you just the most important take-home message from the analysis of Simon's Simplex collection, that we learn that de novo mutations that are not present in parents, but present only child, play very important role. So basically, these mutations are, of course, happening during gametogenesis or very early stages after fertilization. So when you have such large collections of samples and genomic information available, you can test different hypotheses. You can, of course, go to databases and pick your gene of interest, but you can also use this data to test different hypotheses. My lab was very interested in analysis of copy number variants. Many other labs were very interested in genome-wide association. This is not the latest result from genome-wide association in autism, but it's very illustrative for what I want to share with you. Basically, in contrast to other psychiatric disorders, in autism, we do not have such a strong, or we have very, very few genome-wide significant hits. But the new aspect in analysis of complex disorders, and very important aspects that we are now trying to describe and explain to everybody who was very much against GWAS, is that many hits that are not reaching genome-wide significance contributes significantly to liability to disorder. So basically, how much of total additive genetic variation due to segregation of these other variants can be still tagged by SNPs that are on the array? So basically, it's very, very important to keep in mind that many of these stop hits are really contributing to risk. So this type of result is useful to now compare four different disorders. So basically, on this slide here, you can see relative contribution of common genetic variation that comes from GWAS studies, from studies of rare inherited variants and rare de novo variants. And we can start with severe intellectual disability, where majority of risk comes from de novo variants. Situation is very different in these other psychiatric disorders. On the other hand, in autism, almost 10% of liability comes from rare de novo variants that I mentioned already come primarily from analysis of SSC collection. On the other hand, using this novel method of analyzing SNP heritability, it's absolutely clear that significant percentage, 50% of liability actually comes from these common genetic variants. And then you can see here also that there is a small contribution from rare inherited variation. So this is also a little bit confusing because these rare inherited variants have much stronger effect than common variants, but since they are so rare, their percentage contribution to liability is much, much lower. However, many of us like to focus exactly on this rare inherited variants, and I'm going to give you two vignettes from my own or collaborative work. So basically, very early studies in autism, for instance, family-based studies performed by several groups, revealed importance of synaptic genes to autism risk. And I'm illustrating here only two molecules that interact transsynaptically, neurexin and neuroligan. In our early work on copy number variants, we were able to identify several clusters. And my lab and my group was not the only one. The same clusters were identified by many groups using similar approaches. And I'm showing you this slide because it really illustrates complexities of analyzing rare inherited variants. Each of these deletions in red or duplications in green are unique. When you find three individuals with the same variant, these are basically individuals from the same family. However, inheritance patterns are complex. Basically, you have families where two autistic kids have same deletion, but this deletion is also present in unaffected father. Or in another family, we have deletion that's not present in several thousand of control subjects. However, it's present in two unaffected family members, and only one among three affected have these deletions. So it's basically clear that these risk factors, and these are relatively strong risk factors, do not work in isolation. There are many, many other genes. There is this background of mutations, and I can say that I am actually right now working on the background. Another example is a family with neuroligand mutation. So this is this transsynaptic partner of neurexin. I had a mini sabbatical in Japan several years ago, and I was able to convince my host, Dr. Toru Takumi, to actually pursue characterization of this family. So we identified non-synonymous mutations in neuroligand, also present in unaffected mother. And I managed also to convince Toru to investigate functional impact of this mutation, but not in isolation. I actually convinced him to take several other mutations that we identified in individuals with autism, and they were not present in thousands of controls. Situation changed because we did find some of these mutations in genomes of, for instance, one individual among 60,000 individuals in exome aggregation consortium. So these are so-called extremely rare or ultra-rare variants, and we never know whether this one individual in large group of controls maybe had some autistic features. So we performed extensive bioinformatics analysis to predict pathogenicity of all these variants. We identified three that are likely to be pathogenic and some that are less likely to be pathogenic. So Toru's lab performed extensive functional characterization. I'm illustrating here only two tests. One was analysis of cellular localization in primary hippocampal neurons, and second one is formation of spines in dendrites. And it was very interesting because variants that were predicted to be deleterious actually had stronger effect. So basically, they did not translocate to plasma membrane. They stayed, neuroligands stayed in the soma. Or here we have decreased number of spines that are formed. So they were able to pick one of these variants for knock-in mice. This was, for me, very informative. First of all, homozygote mice, they did not have any behavioral anomaly. However, they were able to detect anomalies in social interaction and in dominance test only in heterozygote mice. And I'm saying that because I went through the literature to find examples of more severe phenotypes in heterozygotes than in homozygotes, and I think I couldn't find anything. But in my view, it's extremely, extremely important to record such findings. And of course, it's very likely that redundancy could be possible explanation for this result. So these are just vignettes. My message is that there are hundreds of genes already associated with autism and probably thousands more that need to be found. This is just a different representation of slides that I showed you already. So we are very comfortable. When I say we, I mean because I consider myself model organism geneticist. So we are very comfortable working with either rare or inherited variants that have strong effect. But we do need to address all this common variation because they certainly play important role. And more importantly, there are many, many more genes that have to be discovered. So basically, with the introduction that I gave you at the beginning when I talked about combined mutagenesis, balancer screen, and dominant behavioral screen, you, and from my title, of course, you can see where I'm going with that. So I tried to, and Monica will probably remember that I've been talking about essential genes for 15 years. I was not able to convince anybody to work on that problem. For a reason, because you really need two things. You need good catalog, extensive catalog of essential genes, and if you're interested in our load of mutations, we need whole genome sequence. And my postdocs were completely uninterested in analyzing genome of Watson and Wendner. So all this started once when we had sequence available for 1,000 genomes. They turned to knockout mice to make a catalog using information that's available in MGI. So here, with a little bit more detail, so we started with so-called legacy data, and then I was invited by Steve Murray to collaborate with the International Mouse Phenotyping Consortium. There was a lot of work to carefully curate these essential genes. We grab them using more than 40 MP or mouse phenotype mouse phenotypes, and then we did very, very careful analysis of one-to-one mouse human homologs. It was very interesting that while this MPC embryonic lethal paper was under review, reviewers insisted that we should take advantage of data that were becoming available for humans, because during that review, within a month, three papers came out with results of in vitro assays for cell lethals in many different cell lines. And we performed very extensive analysis and showed that there is a great overlap between genes that are lethal or essential in all these lines and information that we were getting from the mouse. There were a few exceptions, and I can tell you about these exceptions later. But the key aspect is that by combining these two resources, we have now a catalog of almost 4,000 essential genes. And this number is probably higher, and I haven't updated during last few months. So we performed extensive bioinformatic analysis of essential genes. Many of these analyses were performed earlier on a much, much smaller data set. We showed that essential genes are enriched for human disease genes, not only for Mendelian diseases, but we had a big surprise because we turned to GWAS catalog and we grabbed all maybe 3,000 or 4,000 hits, and we looked as genes that are surrounding these GWAS hits, because majority of GWAS hits are intergenic regions. So you can see that this data set is very diluted because it's probably one or the other gene that really contributes to the phenotype. But even with these genes from GWAS catalog, we were getting an enrichment of essential genes. We showed that essential genes are likely to be haploinsufficient. The initial result came from the analysis of mouse genome informatics, but in order to share these results with human genetics community, we had to convince them again that it's relevant. So there is a ClinVar resource that has different categories of evidence for importance of haploinsufficiency, and we got actually much stronger signal using this ClinVar data. And now I'll turn to a few words about intolerance to mutations. So this analysis of intolerance to mutations in humans was performed using a new data set that's available now, much, much larger than when we used it originally, 60,000 subjects in exome aggregation consortium. And we used two algorithms for the analysis of intolerance to mutations. One is so-called residual variation intolerance score that tallies all non-synonymous mutations. And the other one is intolerance to loss of function mutations. And we got very similar result. In red are essential genes. In green is extremely valuable set of controls. These are genes that associate with specific phenotype in MGR or IMPC, but they are not embryonic lethal. And then we compared it to all genes in the genome. So you can see that these essential genes are in this most 25% of most intolerant genes. So human genetics community completely embraced intolerance to mutations as a criteria for functional impact. What we still have to work on is to convince them that there is a difference between non-tolerant genes that are not lethal and those that are essential. So why? And I'm showing very controversial set of slides, and you can criticize me and give me feedback. Let's consider two groups of genes that are non-essential and genes that are essential, and these dots are, let's say, alleles where loss of function allele is in red, and hypomorph allele is in yellow. It is very important to keep in mind that there are no two separate groups, that there is actually a continuum. We are aware that there are many subviable lines, and also in human in vitro experiments, there are many genes that are lethal only in some cells, not in others. So now if we take a gene that's intolerant to mutations, but not lethal, for example, one of the recessive mutations in humans, you will have homozygote loss of function mutation is going to give you phenotype. On the other hand, in lethal, with the essential genes, homozygote loss of function mutants, we will not see them in a human population. There are many combinations, for instance, particularly loss of function in a hypomorph allele. You will not see it if you do population-based studies. Based on our haploinsufficiency results, we know that many of these other alleles and combinations are going to have disease phenotype. So it means that this mutational spectrum is very different between two different groups. So basically, for us who are interested in modeling human disease, going to disease databases and finding combinations of alleles will bring us much, much closer to mutants that should have some disease phenotype. So how are essential genes, or are essential genes relevant to specific disease? We turn to autism. And I forgot to tell you when I talked about Simons Foundation and Simons Simplex Collection, Simons Foundation has a great list of genes that are associated to autism. There are curators who go through the literature and who collect names of genes that were associated with autism, and then a great, great group of junior faculty working in autism research actually plays these genes into different categories. The special category are syndromic. It's syndromic genes, Mendelian diseases that are associated with autism. And as you can see here, genes with stronger evidence for association with autism have higher enrichment of essential genes. That was just the first step. The second step is analysis that I really, really value, and we have it in supplemental material for our gene lists. This is a new test developed by Mark Daly and recently used also by Sanders. It's a transmission and de novo association test, or TADA test. So this is a test that integrates findings from both case control and family-based association studies and information from copy number variants. So it's basically a score. Each gene in the genome has a TADA score. So we ask about strength of genetic association signal between all the essential genes, non-essential genes, and autism. So when we compare expected TADA score and observed TADA score, you can see that essential genes are more likely to harbor true ASD risk genes. So basically here we are not looking just at the most stringent criteria at false discovery rate of 0.1. We are looking at all genes in the genome. Or if not all genes in the genome, all genes that right now have this label essential or non-essential. So this is another gene level test. So I showed you results on two different gene level tests. But we have exome sequence for 1,700 families that have a child with autism and a healthy a sibling. So we can now ask for this association also using variation data. So we, as I said, we started with the 1,700 prob and sibling pairs, and we looked at association at the effect size of the difference between these two pairs in essential and non-essential genes. We're getting signal only with essential genes. We replicated finding that we published several years ago, that this strong association comes with de novo variants, but now we have replicated on probably three times larger data set. And we do also have a signal with inherited variants. So much stronger signal with de novo variants is not surprising, because these are genes under strong, strong selection, and they will probably not be transmitted to the next generation. So everything that I told you so far was generated with a large, large list of essential genes, 4,000 genes. We need smaller data sets. Basically, we have to formulate and test multi-hit disease models, because we are basically now having, we have now individual level whole genome sequence data, and we cannot go with 4,000 genes. It's important to break these genes into smaller pathways. That's important because we want to also test two different models. In one model, we have mutations in the same individuals, mutations in multiple pathways, and with additional mutations, we're increasing risk of the disease. Another model is interaction within pathway, and actually it's surprising in the human genome when you look at these predicted deleterious mutations, how many of these you could actually get in the same pathway. So it's basically buffering of the system. So here we have within particular pathway additional risk alleles. So in order to get pathways and interacting genes, we turn to human expression data. So these are data that are deposited in BrainSpan or Atlas of Developing Human Brain. These are data on a large number of samples across 16 different human brain tissues and structures over 31 developmental stages, 8 of them pre-birth. And we are using a weighted correlation network analysis to get these interacting genes. So this is now, these are modules, 41 modules that we got with all genes in the genome. And our first question is, are there modules that are enriched for essential genes? Yes, there are 11 modules. So I was a little bit surprised with this result because we performed extensive expression analysis using publicly available data. And we were aware that many essential genes are ubiquitously expressed. Many of them are also tissue specific. So we were basically expecting that essential genes are going to fall into this category, just flat across different tissues. This is not the case. They have very dynamic expression pattern when we look at temporal expression. Our next step was now turn to TADA score and ask which modules have genes with the highest TADA score. And these identified three modules. These modules are large, with large number of genes, and approximately between one third and one half are essential, already known essential genes. There will be many more ones when we have complete catalog. It is also surprising to see that in at least in two modules, expression pattern is very, very high in very early stages of development. So a field expected, and this is something that we learned over the last few years, that these are late stages of fetal development when these genes may be important. But when we go with, this is true for synaptic genes. On the other hand, when we go to essential genes, their expression level is extremely high at early stages of development. This is not new results. This is in terms of enrichment and pathways, a gene, known gene function, we are basically just replicating what other people already reported, that these are genes that are involved in chromatin organization, in transcriptional regulation, or in zonal guidance. I told you that many genes have still not been associated with autism, so we are still looking for new genes. So we can now use criteria that we have used before. And using this criteria, we identified 29 essential genes as novel candidate genes for autism because they are co-expressed with high confidence ASD genes. They harbor de novo and inherited loss of function mutations in ASD probands. So these data already exist, ready to be modeled in model organisms, and their suggestive genetic association signal is high, however more relaxed than 0.1, so in this case it's 0.5. So it's late, and my conclusion and take-home message is extremely, extremely simple. genes that are necessary for survival and fitness are important for both Mendelian and complex disorders, and it's mutational load, not the fact of a single gene or single allele, but it's mutational load in essential gene that plays significant role in genetic basis of autism. You are probably asking, where is this going? What's the next step? So first of all, I hope that this is going to be our community that will help us to complete this catalog of essential genes. We're extending our findings to other complex disorders and preterm birth, because it turns out in preterm birth, this load of mutations is also very important. My lab is currently involved in the analysis of 12,000 genomes in Penn Biobank, where we have linked to electronic medical records. So we are looking at mutational load and in individual mutations that are predicted to have strong effect. And in my view, characterization of both coding and non-coding variants of essential genes in model organism and an experimental setting is going to be extremely careful, extremely important. And I'm not saying experimental setting in human cells or iPS cells. In my view, in vitro assays using mouse cells, mouse tissues are going to be very important. So to be able to do it on a large scale and then cherry pick those that are going to be used in CRISPR experiments. At the end, I would like to acknowledge former and current members of my lab, great collaborators at Penn, Steve Marai, many, many people at IMPC and MGI, and all of them, Vern, Lennox Lab, Salter's Lab, Cecilia, who is here, John Schimenti, Jonah Doe, and many, many other collaborators. Thank you, and I will be glad to answer your questions. Fernando.
Great talk, Maja. One thing that you didn't touch at all is the difference.
It's the different prevalence between males and females for ASD, and how that plays with genetics and the fact that there's nothing on the X that you have found.
Yes. So first of all, there is something that I was ready to explain or describe for this audience, and it's polygenic risk score. We play a lot with polygenic risk scores. So you can use GWAS data and summary statistics from GWAS data to basically predict autism status in another population. So others published, but I have noticed that very early on. Polygenic risk score in mothers and children is similar. Essentiality score that we did not publish, but we have data, essentiality score in mothers and children is the same, and it's lower in fathers. So it's absolutely clear now, and this is evidence that comes from analysis of copy number variants from many labs, that basically there is something protective in females. It's interesting, but you know, I did not go into there, yeah.
Other questions? We have microphones right there in the middle. Otherwise, I bring it to you.
Yeah, so Maja, I was wondering how that difference in sex bias and then in the potential protection in females plays into the human phenotyping. So in particular, it was the Simon Simplex collection.
Yes.
I mean, how do you know that somebody does not have autism?
So basically the nice aspect is that we are not using just diagnosis. These individuals, including parents, are taking very extensive set of questionnaires. So we are now doing quantitative analysis. So it's not just yes, no. We're doing quantitative analysis. And in many cases, individuals, parents that I said who are unaffected, they are borderline for some of quantitative traits. And it is also very interesting, we did analysis of mutational burden using these quantitative traits. And something very interesting, both essential and non-essential genes are contributing equally to intelligence. But in terms of social interaction, these were essential genes who had stronger contribution than non-essential genes.
There is another question first, and then Alex.
Hi, I'm Alex Johnson. I'm from Oakland University in the United States. Great talk, by the way. I had a quick question. What are your thoughts on the current or recent research that the microbiome might play a role in ASD?
Yeah, great question. There are really, really strong data. I remember it was a Cell paper from a colleague at Caltech that microbiome affects specifically social interaction, not so much autism diagnosis, but social interaction. And my view is that this is heterogeneity. It's incredibly, incredibly heterogeneous disorder, and it's very likely that there are going to be subtypes where microbiome plays more important role than in others. And the same thing with essentiality status. It's also going to be subtype where this is going to play a higher role. But including microbiome and something that I never ever touched, but it's absolutely clear that we will have to do, it's a mitochondrial genome. So fortunately, when you do exome sequencing, you do get mitochondrial genome. And usually you go through steps to eliminate it, but we have a colleague at Penn who is actually doing mitochondrial haplotyping. And it's a very, very good question because our signal was not strong enough when we looked at single gene mutations. Our signal was not strong enough when we looked at CNVs only. Once when we started to integrate these findings, we are getting stronger signal. So this is going to be one of the important components.
Thank you.
Next question is right here.
Great talk. A lot of the essential genes presumably affect the heart or cardiovascular development.
Yeah.
So does that mean most of those genes also are involved in the brain, or is there some weird interaction going on?
So it's very, very interesting. So we did not look here specifically. In my other world, I work on bipolar illness, and we are now publishing a finding that many of bipolar individuals in our large, large Amish pedigree actually have ApoB variants that are associated with dominant hypercholesterolemia and also with polygenic risk score for cholesterol. We can actually see the difference between affected and unaffected. So that's something that we see in bipolar, we don't see it in autism. Similarly, we're not getting any signal with essential genes in bipolar illness.
There is next question, and then Lourdes.
Yeah, I'm Devasmita from NICER at Bhubaneswar in India. The question is, how does gene redundancy play a role for essentiality?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. So we know, and this is something that Monica, I think that your former postdoc also showed a long time ago. It's definitely sure that if you have paralogs, that is less likely that you will see a lethal phenotype. And it's actually very interesting. I have to give credit to MGI. So my student showed me a list of essential genes, and I looked, and RAB3A is on that list. INGREL is on this list, and I said, something must be wrong. It turns out if you are not careful, you will get this lethal or embryo lethal, even in the paper where two paralogs or knockouts for two paralogs are crossed. So actually, we have almost 600 cases where reports on double mutants are reported. Yeah, so That's a great question.
So do you think mice with the CRISPR and the possibility of making multiple mutations can still play a role for putting some meaning in all these many
absolutely.
Candidates that you have?
No, absolutely. My view, and this is why, this is what I did not say, but some of you are probably reviewers of the Japanese paper. Basically, pedigree that I showed you with neuroligand mutation, the same pedigree has point mutation in three other synaptic genes. And there is another synaptic gene that is very likely contributing, and they're already analyzing knock-in mice. So we're taking one pedigree and then recreating in the mouse mutations that we see in that pedigree.
Mm-hmm. Okay, one question in the front.
That was a great talk, Maja. As always, learned a lot from you. I have a question regarding, in thinking about essential genes, I may be wrong, but the assumption is you're thinking about pathogenicity. But is it possible those variants in essential genes could have sort of a suppressor effect? And it's really a combination of pathogenic and suppressive effects that determine who survives.
Yes.
And so how do you look at that?
So my view, so there are lots of CRISPR screens going on in human cells. And there is huge amount of information that they're really throwing away. And these are these synthetic combinations. And in my view, doing something like that on a large scale, you know, I had to make this major mental switch from trying to go everything one at a time in the mouse. In my view, having an intermediate step to test lots of combinations in vitro first to get to that. And especially for, you know, cell viability, that's maybe easier.
Okay, there is a last question, then we move on to the more social wine part where we can still ask many questions to Maja.
And my answers are going to be more creative.
Okay, last question, please.
Yeah. Monika Baniowski from IGBMC France. I have a question. In last decades, the cases of autism, autism spectrum disorders exploded. Is it because of the better diagnosis, or it's some environmental impact that also plays a role?
Yeah, so for this, I definitely need a glass of wine. And so basically, it's clear that prevalence is going up. So this study by Center for Disease Control is incredibly well controlled. So they're using same criteria over last, I think, 15 years. And with same criteria, these numbers are going up. So on one hand, we are better in diagnosing autism. On the other hand, in my view, there is something environmental. I will tell you two studies that I'm now planning. One is in Croatia, where they have great records of a status for every kid who is starting school, and it looks like prevalence is lower. And another case is in the Amish. There's also a possibility that this prevalence is lower in the Amish. And doing genetics and epidemiological study in parallel is going to be really critical for, you know, one option is that when Amish found their population, there was a handful of people who moved from Alsace to Lancaster, Pennsylvania. One option is that they just did not have risk alleles. Another option is that there is something in their environment. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot. A hand to Maja Bucan.
Also, I have to tell you, it wasn't Maja Bucan. It was an alien who gave a talk for her.
Okay, so we're going to move with the alien to the wine bar.